Welcome to the Life and Death in Ancient Egypt Gallery at Leicester Museum and Art Gallery. When we think of ancient Egypt, it is often to do with death. This is because the large memorial sculptures and tomb buildings are usually the only things to have survived the passage of time. In this gallery, we look at their important rituals around death, but we also explore life and how normal Egyptians lived day to day. Almost everything in this gallery is more than 3,000 years old, and some objects much older than that. In ancient times, and as it is today, most of Egyptian society was concentrated around the River Nile, which is the largest river in Africa. In this gallery, there is a wall-length artwork depicting the Nile, which shows people in boats, fishing, and catching birds for food. The artwork includes images of lotus flowers and tilapia fish, both seen as a symbol of fertility. Also included is the papyrus plant, which was used to make paper, sandals, rope, and other important items. The image is a reproduction of an artwork found in the tomb of Mena, one of the best preserved 18th dynasty tombs in Egypt. The 18th dynasty lasted from around 1550 to 1290 BC. This part of the gallery is large, bright, and contains many glass cases holding a variety of precious objects discovered in Egypt, and three amulets that were found in Leicester. This local connection is because there was a crossover of hundreds of years between the ancient Egyptian society and Roman society. In 30 BC, Egypt became a province of Rome due to the Roman Emperor Octavian's continuing takeover of the country. The Romans, already fascinated by ancient Egypt, assimilated the Egyptian culture with their own. Some Egyptian objects found their way to Leicester, which was an important Roman town 2,000 years ago. These objects were found by amateur archaeologist and Leicester resident Noel B. Spurway, less than a mile from Leicester Museum and Art Gallery. Food was an important part of Egyptian culture, and the richer people in society ate a wide selection of meat, including beef, mutton, and goat, as well as a wide variety of poultry, including duck, crane, heron, and fish. Honey, grapes, dates, figs, and wine were also very popular. The poorer people in Egyptian society didn't eat as much meat, but still ate a wide variety of poultry and fish, as well as vegetables, nuts, and fruit. The main staple of their diet was bread and non-alcoholic beer. Beer was drunk instead of water because it was cleaner after brewing than water. The land around the Nile was fertile and able to provide for the large populations who lived there. This lifestyle is represented in the gallery by a large number of pots on display. Most of these would have been used for food or water storage. Hundreds of thousands of these pots have been found through Egyptian archaeological digs, from the early Old Kingdom up to the New Kingdom, which crossed over with Roman civilization. The pots are made from clay and constructed using a coiling technique, where lengths of clay are coiled into the desired shape and smoothed out on the sides. The pots are usually plain, but some on display here have ornate lines and patterns painted on them. In the gallery is a wooden diorama, which shows a bakery scene with two adults kneading dough and a child figure tending to the oven. This object is one of the oldest items in the gallery, as it's from the Old Kingdom, circa 2000 BCE. The diorama is around 45 centimeters wide, 25 centimeters deep, and 20 centimeters tall, and is carved out of wood. The hairstyles are different to other people's sculptures in the gallery, as fashions changed throughout the centuries. With this being so old, it depicts some of the earlier fashions in ancient Egypt. Models like these were expensive to make, so only those with money could have them. It would have been made to go into the tomb of an important Egyptian dignitary. We know so much about the ancient Egyptians and their daily lives because of the Egyptian written language, hieroglyphics. This pictorial language appeared everywhere you look, inside tombs, temples, and even on the smaller objects displayed here in the gallery. They show not just important people doing important things, but ordinary people doing ordinary things such as farming, eating, and making things. The gallery is split into two distinct spaces. The one we have been hearing about is called the Life Gallery. Now let's explore the Death Gallery. As we enter the Death Gallery, there is a significant change in lighting. It is much dimmer in here than in the Life Gallery, and a little cooler. It's this way because of the delicate nature of the objects displayed here. The fragile bandages that the human remains are wrapped can be damaged by bright light and humidity over a long period of time. The dimmed lights also recreate the feeling of the tombs in which these objects would have originally been found. In the center of the gallery are two large display cases which show the mummified human remains and sarcophagi, or coffin, of Bezenmut and Tarbez, who were brother and sister. These siblings are displayed along with their colorful, highly decorated inner coffin and their cruder, wooden outer coffin. Each layer is shown on a separate shelf. So the way the person's wrapped body was nested into the decorated coffins can be explained. The coffins and ancient Egyptian human remains were both found by French Egyptologist Professor Gaston Maspero in the mid-1800s. John Mason Cook, the son of Leicester's famous tour holiday pioneer Thomas Cook, travelled to Egypt many times during the 1800s. He came into contact with Professor Maspero and bought the remains of Bezenmut and Tarbez from him, bringing them back to England after his travels. In 1885, John Mason Cook donated them to Leicester Museum and Art Gallery. Bezenmut was a priest of the Temple of the Fertility God Min in the 7th century BC at an ancient Egyptian city, now known as Akhmim. Bezenmut's colourful inner coffin shows painted scenes of him with a shaved head and wearing the robes of a priest. The images on his coffin are scenes of Bezenmut being embalmed, judged by the gods, and entering the afterlife. Other depictions and hieroglyphs on the coffin can be considered a list of spells that will help the owner on their journey to the afterlife. Tarbez was a teenage girl in the 7th century BC. She was likely a musician at the temple of the fertility god Min, where her older brother, Bezenmut, was a priest. We know she was still young, as x-rays of her remains show that her wisdom teeth hadn't yet grown in. Tarbez and her brother Bezenmut were brought to the KNH Centre for Biomedical Egyptology in Manchester in the 1970s. There, along with the discovery about her wisdom teeth, was discovered that both brother and sister had a parasite in their system. Studies have shown that this parasite often afflicted ancient Egyptians and was the likely cause of death for Tarbez and perhaps her older brother Bezenmut. Although as Bezenmut was in his mid-40s, he is considered old by ancient Egyptian terms. Schistosomiasis is still prevalent today, but is treated with antibiotics. Ancient Egyptians viewed this life and the afterlife to be the same. So their burial and preparation to take all they needed with them into the tombs was very important. It was imperative that their bodies were as complete and the coffins as lifelike as possible, so the spirit Ka could find the body after they had succeeded in all the trials in the afterlife. The spells on the coffin, along with the Book of the Dead that would accompany the body, would help the spirit to do this. This important ritual was reserved only for those who could afford it. Most of Egyptian society were buried in simple graves in the desert. The process involved a long and complex process, including the removal of the major organs, which were put inside special vessels called canopic jars, which were then put alongside the coffins inside the tombs. As you might guess, this process was expensive and reserved only for those that could afford it. Finally, in the Death Gallery, there are many scarab beetle figures on display. The significance of these, also known as dung beetles, is that they represent birth, life, death, and resurrection. The rolling of the dung ball by the beetle was believed to represent the cycle of life. Their eggs hatch from under the sand, representing rebirth, which brings us back into the Life Gallery, where the whole process starts again.